Sushruta for Neet is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
So good morning, students. Today we are going to start a new chapter, a phrase, the p-block elements. And whenever we talk about the p-block elements, you must remember the periodic table. And we know that the periodic table, entire periodic table, is divided into four different blocks. And these four different blocks belongs to, while writing electronic configuration, in which orbital or in which subshell we are putting the last electron. Based on that, we say that electronic periodic table can have four different blocks. So the p blocks are the block is the part of the element or the part of the periodic table, or the p block elements are those elements which in which the last electron goes to p orbital or p subshell while writing the electronic configuration. And we know how one can write the electronic configuration using a Hubbaugh principle. Just get the sum of n plus l in, and based on that you can build up the entire electronic configuration. The last electron enters the outermost p orbital, the number of p orbitals, and also what we know, the number of p orbitals are 3 for any cell belonging, whatever the corresponding subshell, the p subshell, there will be 3 orbitals, and 3 orbitals, and what we know, one orbital can occupy maximum 2 electrons, so there can be maximum 6 electrons in p orbitals of a particular subshell, a particular cell, particular energy level. Because one energy level will have only p orbital, and so, and similarly s and the d and f may also be available there. So, but it means that you can have maximum 6 electrons in p orbitals, and that is why in the periodic table you will see only 6 groups belonging to the p block elements, and that means the maximum number of electrons that can accommodated in set of p orbitals is 6 that I have explained. So consequently there are 6 groups of p block elements in the periodic table, and their number from 13 to 18. 13 to 18, if you look at the periodic table from here, 13, 14, 15, 16 and 18. And when we know, I have explained it earlier as well, these first two groups, they belong to s block, and this group belong third to 12th, they belong to D block. And why D block? There are 10 groups in this, the D block, because D orbitals can, the D subshell can have 5 orbitals, and 5 orbitals can have 10 electrons. And if you just put one electron, and we know as you increase the number of electrons in the neutral atom, same number you have will also have to increase the number of protons into the nucleus. And if the number of protons is differing in the nucleus, the element will change. And that's why we have 10 different elements, 10 different groups in the periodic table for the D block. And the A block element that we know, they should ideally be here. The lanthanide should be ideally occupy this place, the 6th period, 3rd group, the entire 15 elements, and actinide should occupy this place, 7th period and 3rd group, entire thing. But the thing is, if you write entire this series, lanthanide and actinide series, you will not be able to accommodate the entire periodic table into one page. So just to accommodate entire periodic table in one page, people have written that these two series below the periodic table, and these two series contains 15 elements from lanthanum to lutetium, and that is the lanthanide, and from actinium to lawrencium, the actinide series. And so this series, because the last electron goes to f orbital, so they are also called f block elements. And f block elements, d block elements are called transition elements, and f block elements are called inner transition elements. Please remember one thing, this transition element, this group particularly are not usually called transition element for the particular reason that we will see later on. Now the thing is, if you look at the periodic table, what we have seen basically here, the first two elements, again I am repeating, first two groups, these are alkali metals and alkaline earth metals group, they belong to S block, and then these 6 groups, they belong to P block. So boron family, these are different groups, and all the groups are named, and the boron, first member of this group is boron, second and first member of this group is carbon, first member of this group is nitrogen, first member of this group, this is group is what, the group 16 is oxygen, this is group 13, 14, 15, 16, group 17, first member is fluorine, and group 18, that is the noble gases, its first member is helium, and then neon, the corresponding element here will be neon. So based on the first members, we also call the particular, we name these groups as a family. So boron member, first member boron, boron family, carbon family, nitrogen family, first member oxygen, so oxygen family. Here in this case, you can call fluorine family. Here the helium family you can call. The thing is, halogens, usually the fluorine family elements are more often, their more common name is the halogens, and not only the halogens or the fluorine family members, also the oxygen family members are called chalcogen or chalcogen, C-H-L-C-O-G-E-N, chalcogen family. Nitrogen family members are also known as nictogen family, P-N-I-C-T-O-G-E-N, so nictogen family. And this is called the tetrail family. Why tetrail? Because this family element, they form four bonds quite often. So they are called tetrail, and this is called the trial family. So tetrail and trial, just now people have started using in literature, but up to the nictogen. So halogen, chalcogen, nictogen is quite often, and more oftenly, even in many places you will see even in the book. So you should remember halogen, chalcogen, nictogen. Halogen for the fluorine family members was group 17, chalcogen for group 16, oxygen family member, nictogen for group 15, nitrogen family members. What is the other point that we see here is that this is the metals that you see, alkali metals. This is also metal, transition metals, inner transition metals, a block elements. So what you see, the all the three other than p block elements, all the other part of the periodic table contains only metals. This is the only p block, it is the only block, only portion of the periodic table which contains also the non-metals and metalloids. Non-metals and metalloids are also are the only part of the p block element. This is what you have to remember. And so if you look at the periodic table, if you just draw a diagonal line between boron and astatine, this is astatine, boron and astatine. All the elements that come on this line are metalloid. All the elements on this line will be metalloid, and some elements nearby this line. So suppose you just drawing this line. So this germanium and also this antimony, stibium, so Latin name. So antimony and germanium, they will also be very close to this line. So they are metalloid. So these few elements, boron, silicon, germanium, arsenic, antimony, tellurium, astatine, they are metalloid. All the elements to the right of this line are mostly non-metals. They are non-metals, and all the elements below this line or left to this line are metals. So P block contains metals, metalloids and non-metals all. And so the metalloids are only into the P block, non-metals are only in the P block. However, all the other three blocks contain only metals. And these are different, these different colors are mostly shown because these elements are highly radioactive, their high half-life is very small, and that is why they have different colors, mostly because of that. Another point is from the polonium onwards, polonium, astatine, radon, they are very highly radioactive. So you see all the members after the polonium, astatine, radon, nihonium, plerovium, moscovium, livermorium, tenascine, and oganesson. They are all radioactive and they are highly unstable. They have very highly unstable nucleus. That is why their chemistry is also not understood well for particularly these elements. And so we will mostly be focusing up to the bismuth. Whatever the chemistry we will be studying, chemistry we will be studying of the elements which are up to the bismuth only, 33 atomic number. And I hope this point is clear. So what the elements above this line, so boron to astatine, above this line or right to this line are non-metals. So carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, selenium, bromine, iodine, then xenon, radon, krypton, argon, neon, helium, these are all only non-metals that we have, non-metallic elements that we know. And all the elements that this boron, silicon, germanium, arsenic, this I have explained, they're metalloid. And this aluminium, gallium, iridium, tin, thallium, lead, bismuth, polonium, and these elements as well, they are all metals. And they are metals. And so what we know, so this again, this P block of the periodic table contains metalloid, metals and non-metals all. If you go by the 13, this all the elements, the group 13, this family, the boron family or the tetrail family, or the tetrahedral group. These are boron, aluminium, gallium, iridium, thallium, neonium. This is the carbon, silicon, germanium, tin, lead, flerovium. This nitrogen, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, bismuth, moscovium, oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium, polonium, livermorium, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, astatine, tennessine. These are the elements. So what we will be focusing on only the thallium up to here. So the these elements up to the thallium, group 14 up to the lead, group 15 up to bismuth, group 16 only up to the tellurium, group 17 only up to iodine, and group 18 only up to xenon will be there in our syllabus, and that is only our focus. So main group, so what we also know, the main group elements, so group S block elements and P block elements, they are together called main group elements or the representative elements. What again, the S block elements and P block elements, they are together called main group elements or the representative elements. So alkali metals and alkaline earth metals, they belong to main group elements. The boron family, carbon family, nitrogen family, oxygen family, halogen family, or the fluorine family, you can call the halogens, chalcogens, nictogen, tetrahyl, triale, they all belong, and the noble gases, that one group, they all belong to the main group elements. So all group vertical columns found in the periodic table are called families. So all the groups or the vertical columns are what we call the families. And all the elements in each group or the family share many physical and chemical properties. So they have very similar, many of them have very similar chemical and physical properties. One trend in the periodic table is that elements of the same family share same properties. So the valence shell electronic configuration of this particular P block element, if you have to write what we will write, it is NS2NP126. 126 because there could be element with NS2. 2NP1, NS2NP2, or up to NS2NP6. So except the only exception is helium, which is its electronic configuration is 1s2, and the only exception that we see here is the helium, because it has only two electrons, so it cannot have this much. And also it has only s orbital in its valence shell, because it is the first period element, and first period element, the value of n is 0, n is 1, the principal quantum number is 1, the value of l will be what? Value of l will also be 0, which means the only s orbital is available for helium. So it doesn't have any p orbital in this. Other than that, although because of the properties of the helium, we put it along the noble gases, but it doesn't have, it may not one consider that it doesn't have p orbital. One thing that you should remember, why it doesn't have p orbital, because if you know the quantum number, the principal quantum number for helium is what? 1. And principal quantum number of helium is 1, it means the azimuthal quantum number will be what? 0 to n minus 1. So 0 to 1 minus 0, 0. So it has only 0 belongs to the s orbital. So it has only s orbital, it doesn't have p orbital. Although we have written it in the p block because of its similarity in the properties with this noble gases, because this is also a noble gas, and it's all of its orbitals, whatever the orbitals that are available, they are completely filled. And we also see the all the orbitals of the elements that belong to this particular group, there all the orbitals are completely filled. So helium is also because of those properties are put together. Now the thing is, so the difference in inner core of elements greatly influence their physical properties as well as chemical properties. Consequently, a lot of variation in properties of elements in group of p block is observed, and a lot of difference in properties of the same group that we see. This is because the core electrons vary. Core electrons vary. What we see in the one case, the helium, we see there is no core electron, that is all the electrons are valence electrons. In the case of neon, when we see, in the case of neon, what we see, the core electrons only be the 1s2. In the case of this same period, also the only the one s and p orbitals will be there as a core electron, because here what we know, the 1s2, 2s2, these are the core electrons for all the elements that are here in this period. In this case, what we see that these electrons will also, because all the elements, that 2p electrons will also be the core electrons for this. So one is 2s and 3s, and 2p electrons will be the core electrons for the elements belonging to this period, this part. Then we see the d electrons also coming in between. And d electrons from here, the f electrons are also coming in between. So because of this, there is a lot of variation in the core electrons. And because of the core electrons, there are a lot of variations. These core electrons go to different orbitals, and different orbitals, we know their penetration power is different. And because of their penetration power, their screening effect also is different. And sometimes if the number of value of L increases, means from if we go from S to F orbitals, usually what we see, the screening value of these orbitals, what it decreases, and if it decreases because their penetration power decreases, S is mostly more closer to the nucleus, its penetration power is more, and because of that we also will see something, the inert pair effect. And the another thing is that another point is that the D block contraction and A block contraction, these kind of terms we will see, because the electrons going to the A orbital, they will not contribute to the screening constant that much. However, the neutrons are also increasing in the nucleus, and so effective nuclear charge will increase consequently to a larger extent. And because of that, what we will see, the aluminium and gallium. Aluminium, the atomic radii is more than the gallium, and usually what we expect, but if we go from top to bottom in a group, atomic radius should increase. But what we see, if you go from aluminium to gallium, gallium is smaller in size than the aluminium. This is why? Why? This is because the D presence of the 10D electrons. And 10D electrons will not have that much screening constant. The shielding will be less. And because the shielding will be less and the atomic charge is increasing, so because of that, effective nuclear charge will increase. And effective, because of the high effective nuclear charge, although the one extra cell is added to gallium as we move from aluminium. So one extra cell is added to gallium. However, even with the increase in one extra cell, whatever the contraction in the all the cells will be very high, and so the gallium atomic radius is just smaller. And that is what we call the D block contraction. So those things we will see a bit in detail. So consequently, a lot of variation in properties in the group of P block elements is observed. This is because the difference, lots of difference in the core electrons, and thus the number of possible oxidation states increases towards the right in a period as well. And because the number of electrons will also be increasing, and number of electrons will be increasing, so number of possible oxidation state will also increase. But because what we know, the number of possible oxidation state, the maximum oxidation state could be equal to the number of electrons that are available into the outermost shell. And the minimum oxidation state could be 8 minus whatever the number of electrons that are there in the valence shell. These things we have studied earlier. So if you look at the general electronic configuration of different group elements, so third group 13, group 15, 14, and so all. So group 13, the general electronic configuration will be NS2NP1. And NS2NP1, as I said, group 14, it will be NS2NP2. And so group 15, NS2NP3. Similarly, group 17, group 16, you can write, the group 18 will be NS2NP6. NP6, only exception is the helium, which has only 1s2 electronic configuration. So first member, what we know, the first member of group 13 is boron, first member of group 14 is carbon, first member of group 15 is nitrogen, first member of group 16 is oxygen, first member of group 17 is fluorine, and first member of group 18 is helium. The corresponding element of this period, boron, carbon, nitrogen, fluorine, will be neon. However, helium is also a noble gas, and we have put it just above this in the P block. So what we know, helium, so these elements are boron family, carbon family, based on that the name has come. And all the other name, the alternative name, we know, the halogen, chalcogen, nictogen, tetrel, triel. Now the oxidation state, the highest oxidation state, let us look at what they can possess. The highest oxidation state, as I said, will be equal to the number of valence electrons. And the group 13 elements have 3 valence electrons, so it can have plus 3 oxidation state, that is the highest oxidation state. Group 14 elements have only 4 electrons in its valence shell, and so its highest oxidation state that it can show in its compounds is what? It is plus 4. Group 15 elements, we know, like nitrogen, 7 electronic atomic number 7, so electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p. 3. So 5 electrons in valence shell. 5 electron in valence shell means the highest oxidation state it can show is 5, because that is the only electron that it can give in a chemical reaction. The oxygen, 6 electrons oxygen family, and sulfur, selenium, tellurium, that we know. So they can show plus 6 oxidation state as the highest oxidation state. Group 17, we have seen group 17 ClO4 minus perchloric acid. Perchloric acid, chlorine has plus 7 oxidation state. So plus 7 oxidation state would be the maximum oxidation state that the halogen family member can show. And plus 8 oxidation state will be for the noble gas series. The thing is, the highest oxidation state is also called group oxidation state. This term you should remember, group oxidation state. And group oxidation state is what? The highest oxidation state that particular group element can show. Now, what we know, other than highest oxidation state, there will be no certain compounds of these group elements where the oxidation state is different. Like we know water. Water in water oxidation state of oxygen is minus 2. The peroxide oxidation state of oxygen is minus 1. Superoxide oxidation state of oxygen is minus 1/2. So what we know, these group elements, they also show variable valency, variable oxidation state. In particular, you can have the compound of xenon where the oxidation state of xenon is plus 8, plus 6, plus 4. And similarly, what we see in this case, plus 7, plus 5, plus 3, plus 1, minus 1. So the variation usually we see is in the plus, the form of 2. So plus 7, plus 5. Usually normally plus 3, plus 1, then minus 2. So the variation is of 2 here, plus 8, plus 6, plus 4, that we see in the case of oxygen, plus 6, plus 4, plus 2, 0, minus 2. These are the oxidation state we see in the case of oxygen family members. For the nitrogen family members, what we see, the oxidation state, the maximum electron 5 in the valence. So my highest oxidation state plus 5, so plus 5, N2O5 is plus 5, nitrogen is plus 5 oxidation state, then plus 3, plus 1, this is what a 0 it will show, and then we also see the nitrogen also show minus 3 oxidation state. So usually if you go into plus, the difference normally occurs with the plus 2. And here, in the case of carbon family members, plus 4, plus 2. So if you go down the group, and in the case of boron family members, plus 3, plus 1. So these are the oxidation states that we see. So usually the boron family members and all the these three family members, if you go down the group, the oxidation state, lower oxidation state, their occurrence increases means their stability increases. Usually means the plus 4 oxidation state, one can expect that this group element, group 14 group elements, can have plus 4 oxidation state as the highest oxidation state or most stable oxidation state, as it can have 4 electrons. But if you go down the group, you will see the lead, the most stable oxidation state of lead is plus 2. In the case, this case, what we see, the most stable oxidation state of thallium is plus 1. However, if you just go above, we'll see the plus 3 oxidation state is more stable in this case, like aluminium is most stable in its plus 3 oxidation state. Phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, here they show plus 3 oxidation, plus 4 oxidation, in the case of nitrogen, so they show plus 5 oxidation state as most stable oxidation state. However, if you go to bismuth plus 3 oxidation state is most stable oxidation state. And the reason for this is what we call the inert pair effect, that I'll also explain a bit later. So the maximum oxidation state shown by p block elements is equal to the total number of valence electrons, that is the sum of the s and p electrons. So whatever the total number of s and p electrons are there in the outermost shell, so NS2 or and NP, whatever the value of p electrons, which could be 1, 2, 6, whatever the total number that we can add, number of NS electrons and number of NP electrons, and that will be the maximum number of electrons in total number of electrons in the valence shell, and that will also tell us the highest oxidation state that this particular group element can show. So in addition to the group oxidation state, p block elements may also show other oxidation states which normally differ from the total number of valence electrons by unit of 2, and this is what we have seen. So we see plus 2 minus 4 carbon also can show minus 4 oxidation state because it is non-metal. So non-metals usually also show negative oxidation state. So whatever the non-metallic elements will be there in the P block, and that we see here, the carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus here, the non-metallic elements, they also show negative oxidation state, and negative oxidation state as one of the most stable oxidation state for their case. And that is why, that is because their electron acceptor, their electronegative character is more. Electronegative character is more means what? Electron acceptance tendency is more, and because of the electron acceptance tendency, they also show negative oxidation state. So that we see usually the negative oxidation state in the case of non-metals, and these are the non-metals that we know. Non-metals up to the halogen family. Usually the non-metals are also there in the noble gases, but they do not show negative oxidation state because their outermost shell is completely occupied and completely filled so they do not have any vacancy to accept electrons. So the noble gases won't show any negative oxidation state. Other than them, all the other non-metals, they show negative oxidation state because they have certain vacancies to accept electrons in their outermost shell, and those vacancies, and that is what we saw. So negative oxidation state, highest negative oxidation state will be what? The number of valence shell electrons minus 8. So if you look at the carbon, so carbon here, so carbon what can show the highest lowest oxidation state will be what for the carbon, the non-metal, the number, total number of electrons are 4, so 4 minus 8 is minus 4, the lowest oxidation state carbon can show. The lowest oxidation state for nitrogen, and for that matter phosphorus as well, because what we know, phosphorus is also a non-metal. So nitrogen and phosphorus may also show negative oxidation state, and that value, the lowest value will be what? The number of valence shell electrons minus 8. So number of valence shell electrons for the nitrogen and phosphorus are 5. So 5 minus 8 is what? Minus 3. So they can show minus 3 oxidation state as well. In the case of chalcogen families, oxygen, selenium, tellurium, oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium, you can see here. Usually tellurium is metal white, so up to the selenium we will see the number of valence shell electron is what? It is 6. So the lowest oxidation state these elements can show is what? 6 minus 8, and 6 minus 8 is minus 2. So for this family, halogen family members, the fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine, the number of highest total number of valence shell electrons is what? 7. We know the 7 minus 8, the minus 1. So the lowest oxidation state that show is minus 1, and that is what is shown here. And then the positive oxidation state they can also show. And why they show positive oxidation state? Because we know these elements, the other than fluorine, all the elements, there are elements. Fluorine is most highest electronegative element. The highest electronegative element, the fluorine can form bonds with all the metals and non-metals. And if fluorine is forming the bond with any metal and non-metal, all the other elements will be in the plus oxidation state because of the fluorine. Fluorine will pull electron, shared electron pair towards itself, and once it pulls the shared electron pair towards itself, so the other element which is bound to fluorine will have plus oxidation state. So that is why, because, and after the fluorine, oxygen is there, so because of that electronegative character will show. Other point that is very important is if we see there is a bond between a metal and non-metal. If you see here, if you see a bond between a metal and non-metal, metal and non-metal, usually that bond is the ionic bond. And that metal may not be only the P block element metal. That metal may belong to any other block, like S block and even this block element. So usually if the metal forms bond with the non-metals, that bond is normally, in most of the cases, it will be ionic bond. But when the non-metals forms bond within themselves, so the carbon can form bond with the oxygen, the carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, all those compounds are usually covalent compounds. Fluorine can also form bond with the oxygen, OF2. So it with this compound will also be a covalent compound. So hydrogen is another non-metal that is not shown here. So one can show here as well, but usually hydrogen we show outside this thing, as a separate place we put for the hydrogen, and that is also a non-metal. So non-metal, it forms of bond with, whether it with the forms bond with the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, chlorine, any other, sulfur, phosphorus, they will all be the, all the compounds will be the covalent compounds. this is one common thing. So compound formed between non-metals are usually the bond is the covalent bond. Even if the two metals forms a bond, usually sometimes like Hg2+, so two Hg atoms they form, so that kind of bond is mostly usually the covalent type. On the non-metals, they are mostly the covalent. And so in addition to the group oxidation state, p block elements may show other oxidation states which we have seen, which normally differ from the total number of valence electrons by unit of 2. In boron, carbon and nitrogen families, the group oxidation state is most stable oxidation state for the lighter elements in the group. So lighter elements are this boron, carbon, nitrogen family, the group oxidation state, the highest oxidation state is stable only for the lighter elements, and the lighter elements also not for the first member of this. Other than that, so for the lighter elements, what we see, the highest oxidation state is more stable for the lighter elements. However, as you go down the group, oxidation state of 2 unit less than the group oxidation state becomes progressively more stable for the heavier elements in each group due to the inert pair effect. This term you should remember, inert pair effect. We'll see in details later on. So non-metals and metalloid exist only in the p block of the periodic table that I have explained. The non-metallic character of elements decreases down the group. This is the point that we have seen in the periodic table. Let us again consider it. So what it means, the non-metallic character usually decreases as you go down the group, and the metallic character increases. It is normal for the all the elements in the periodic table, all the group elements in the periodic table. We have seen from lithium to cesium, the metallic character increases. Francium, not saying because of radioactivity. Beryllium to barium, the metallic character increases, so the non-metallic character decreases. Here we will see as well, in other cases as well, we see the metallic character usually increases. However, some exceptions we see in these cases, and that these elements of like platinum, gold, iridium, they are not that much reactive in the palladium. So they are not, they are also called some, and those things we'll see in the D block elements, what are the some exceptional rules. The thing is, usually the non-metallic character decreases down the group, decreases down the group, and the metallic character increases. So that is why the elements at this part is what, they are metals. And the highest, the non-metal with the highest non-metallic property will be what, this fluorine, because what we are knowing, as we are going left to right in a period, the non-metallic character is increasing. We see the non-metallic character is increasing from here to here in all the periods. The non-metallic character increases, and if we go from bottom to top, the non-metallic character also increases. So what we see, this the fluorine comes at the place, the noble gases we do not consider because they are very less reactive. And usually the up to the neon and argon, very neon, helium, they do not form any compound. Argon, very drastic condition, it forms certain compounds, has recently been formed. The krypton and xenon, they form certain compounds with highly electronegative elements. So they are very few, very less reactive, and that is why they are called noble gases. In earlier they were known as inert gases because people believe that they do not react, they do not take part in any kind of chemical reaction, so they were known as inert gases. Now they call noble gases because they are ideal gases. They may not, some of them may not be reacting, some of them will react with only few elements, not all the elements. And so what we see, the fluorine is the most electronegative elements, the non-metallic character increasing. So non-metals and metalloids, this point I have already explained. So the change in the non-metallic character of elements decreases down the group. This change from non-metallic to metallic character brings diversity in the chemistry of these elements even within the group. So what we see, the non-metals, metalloids and metals, they all exist only in p-block elements. And we also know that chemical metals, they have different properties, non-metals have different properties, metalloids have different properties. So we see more diversity in the physical and chemical properties of the elements even within the group only in the p-block element. That much diversity we don't see in any other block of elements of the periodic table. So in general, non-metals have higher ionization enthalpies, and that is what we know, and higher electronegativities and higher electron gain enthalpies than the metal. Higher electron gain enthalpies, and when I am saying, I am only talking about the magnitude. If you look at the sign as well, because electron gain enthalpy when it comes, sometimes for the certain element we see it is a negative, because if you put the electron, that becomes exothermic, and it is exothermic with the negative sign. So with the negative sign, more and more negative sign, the value, the number is decreased. Number is a smaller number, and with the smaller number, sometimes you get confused. What I am talking about only the magnitude. So magnitude is, if you consider in the negative magnitude means the exothermicity, which is also for the non-metals increases. So that may be confusing, the magnitude only. So you can have just, I think that is okay. So therefore, in contrast to metals which readily form cations, non-metals readily form anions. So this is point, this point I have already explained. So non-metals form anions because they have also tendency to accept electrons. The compounds formed by highly reactive non-metals with highly reactive metals are generally ionic because of the large differences in their electronegativities. And this thing we have seen in the chemical bonding chapter as well. So if there is a large difference in the electronegativity of the two bonded elements, we see there is an ionic character, more ionic character to that chemical bond. And that is what the no bond usually, if this is not the non-polar covalent bond, is 100% ionic and 100% covalent. It is all the relative contribution, relative how much ionic character and how much covalent character is there. So bond having a higher ionic character is considered as ionic bond, and bond having higher covalent character is called the covalent bond. Like that we see HCl, HCl ionizes. It is a covalent bond. There is a covalent bond between hydrogen and chlorine. But it has certain very high ionic character as well. That is why it ionizes in aqueous solution. And we also see certain metals that do not get ionized in the aqueous solution. That is because of the different regions, the crystal, lattice energy, that and the hydration energy, the other term also because of that covalent character that will be added to them. So in contrast, the compounds formed between non-metals themselves are largely covalent in character because of a small difference in their electronegativities. The change of non-metallic to metallic character can be best illustrated by the nature of oxides they form. So oxides, what we see, which element is a metallic and which is non-metallic, people, there could be one general thing to consider is what kind of oxides they form. If their oxides are basic in nature, then they are metallic, and if their oxides are acidic in nature, they are non-metallic. And if their oxides are having both basic and acidic character, they may be the amphoteric and more closer to the metal white type. So the non-metals oxides are acidic or neutral, and whereas metals oxides are basic in nature. So non-metals oxides may also be neutral, but they are mostly acidic, and the metals oxides are mostly what? They are basic in nature. It doesn't mean all metals oxides will be basic in nature. The aluminium oxide Al2O3 that we see, it's amphoteric in nature. So most of the metals oxides are what we see, they're basic in nature. The first member of P block differs from the remaining members of the corresponding groups in two major ways. This is one point that is very important. If you look at here, and I think that briefly I have explained earlier, I'll just explain it in the detail. So what we see, the first member of this, the boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, mostly this. And here in this case, helium, we are showing the first member if you look here only, because they are only the reactive thing, and that our focus is mostly on the chemistry of this part. So what is first member is different? Why is the first member is different? One thing is the first member, it doesn't contain vacant d orbital. Another thing is what their atomic radius. Atomic radius of the first member is quite smaller than the second member, if you look at the values. And that is because of the other things, because in between d orbital, vacant d orbital is also coming and playing a certain role. So the vacant d orbitals, we see there is no presence of vacant d orbitals in this period element, the boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, even to neon. But once you go from here to here, you see the 3s2 to 3p6. After the 3p6 electrons goes to 4s2, but what we see, the d electrons are also available. And how d electrons are available? Because for the third period elements, the principal quantum number n is what? 3. and the for n is equal to 3, you will have L value of L azimuthal quantum number will be 0, 1 and 2. 0 and 0 belongs to S orbital, 1 belongs to P orbital, and 2 value of L is equals to 2 belongs to D orbitals. Although we are not putting any electron up to here in any D orbital, but what does it mean? It does contain D orbitals, and these D orbitals are empty. They do not have any electrons. And so these D orbitals, but there is availability of D electrons, D orbitals, and that vacant D orbitals will now be available also to accept electrons. And so the elements, if you see here, these elements, they show expanded octet in many of its compounds. However, the boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, they do not show expanded octet. They can have maximum 8 electrons in their outermost shell. What are those elements? The boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, up to neon. They can have maximum 8 electrons into their valence shell. However, in any of their compounds, however, if you go to the other elements of the subsequent period, and from second to third, but we see there is also availability of vacant d orbitals. Here there is availability of vacant 3d orbitals. In these cases, will be vacant 4d orbitals, and from here onward, 5d and 4f is also available. And so that there are many vacant d orbitals here. Most of the changes that we see in these two cases, and these two cases, and availability of vacant d orbitals, these elements show expanded octet. That is one term that we use. And expanded octet, because of the expanded octet, they form certain compounds where they have more than 8 electrons in their valence shell in those particular compounds. And the examples we know for the H2SO4, the sulfuric acid, sulfur has how many electrons? 12 electrons in its outermost shell. And how can it be 12 electrons? And how will it be possible? Because according to octet rule, that what we know, it can have maximum 8 electrons. But the thing is, octet rule is valid only up to here. It is not only valid strictly applied, not valid, it may be valid for other, but it is not strictly applied for the other elements. But it is strictly applied only up to the neon, and particularly from the carbon to fluorine. Neon anyway, it has 8 electrons, so carbon to nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine. And so these points, and let us see the size and all other properties which depends on it. So two ways they differ: the size is much smaller, size of the elements which are in the second period, p block elements are much smaller than the elements in the third period and onwards. And so because of the much difference in the size, and this kind of difference we have also seen for the alkali and alkaline earth metals, when we show the chemistry of alkali and alkaline earth metal groups. So there is a huge difference between lithium, size of lithium, and the size of sodium. There's a huge difference between size of beryllium and that of magnesium. And because of that, what is the similarity we have seen with the S block elements as well. So that's the lightest P block elements. What are the lightest P block elements? The first member of these families. So similar differences as that of the lightest S block elements based on the size. However, what we see, another point, the effect of d orbitals in the valence shell of heavier elements, and the effect of d orbitals, and where it starts, it starts from the third period onwards. So from the third period onwards, all the period elements which belong to the p block, they will have vacant d orbitals, and which applies only to this p block elements. And why it doesn't apply to other S block elements? Because S block elements, P block elements, they are already occupied. The previous cell is already occupied, whatever the available electrons are there mostly. The second period elements of P block, second period elements of P block starting from boron are restricted to a maximum covalency of 4. And that is why strictly what they are showing, strictly following octet rule, means what? They cannot have more than 8 electrons. And more than 8 electrons, they cannot have more than 8 electrons means what? They cannot have more than 4 bonds. And they cannot have more than 4 chemical bonds, because 4 chemical bonds are there, means the 4 into 2, 8 electrons are already there. So they can maximum have 4 bonds. So boron, carbon, nitrogen, and the oxygen cannot have even 4 bonds. The fluorine cannot have even 4 bonds because they also have lone pairs. So nitrogen, if it contains like nitrogen, ammonium. Ammonium, it may donate its electrons, the one lone pair to another, H plus, and so it can form four bonds. So usually the hydronium ion only has three bonds. So anyways, what they cannot have more than four bonds because of this. The second period elements of P block starting from the boron are restricted to maximum of covalency of four using 2s and 3 2p orbitals. There is only one 2s orbital that you know, and thus they follow octet rule. However, the third period elements of P group with the electronic configuration 3s2 3pn have the vacant 3d orbitals that lie between 3p and 4s levels of energy. And 4s levels of energy is 3d orbitals usually lie once you put one electron into the 4s. Until unless you don't put any 4 electron into the 4s, what we'll see the 4s. However, for the third period element, there is no 4s available. 4s orbitals are not available because why? Because they cannot have that much. That liberty is not, but vacancy is there, one can have that. So I think I should not explain that much. So these vacant d orbitals can be used to accept electrons. So vacant d orbitals are there. So vacant d orbitals can be used to accept electrons. So one thing I think here, I might have made some confusing remark. So what you are saying, the 4s orbitals, although there is, one can have like 4s orbitals, that kind of transition one can see even in the third period elements, like S transition, if it is possible, and it can happen. So there is availability of 4 electrons there, 4s orbital is there even for the third period elements. And though this 3d is what it is between them, that is available. However, this 4s is of the very high energy for the third period elements, so that is of very high energy. And for the third period elements, mostly what we see that the 3d is between 4s and 3p. However, once you go to the transition metals, usually after you go to the next pair, after the electron argon, after the argon, what we see, although the d orbitals are available, but electrons go first to the s orbital, 4s orbital, because they are the 4s orbital. The empty 4s orbital is lower in energy than the d orbital, 3d orbitals. So this vacant, thus the third period elements can expand their covalency, and this is what we call the expanded octet. So these vacant d orbitals can be used to accept electrons. So what the example, if you see the while boron forms only BF4 minus what? BF3, boron has only three electrons. It can form three covalent bonds with three fluorine atoms, so BF3. However, one fluoride may come and it can donate its lone pair of electrons to the vacant p orbital of boron. And the vacant p orbitals of the boron, once it donates its electron to the vacant p orbital, what will say? It will be BF4 minus of boron. BF3 has only one vacant orbital, and that is of the p type orbital. However, if you go to the aluminium can have, even it can use, you know, vacant d orbitals as well. And so aluminium can form AlF6 3 minus anion, and AlF6 3 minus anion, you can see 12 electrons are there in the valence shell of the aluminium. And what is this aluminium? AlF3, one can form AlF3, and there is a neutral, and then three fluoride ions may come, and they can use one p orbital and maybe two other d orbitals, one p orbital, 3p orbital, and other two 3d orbitals to form AlF6 3 minus anion. The presence of these 3d orbitals or d orbitals influences the chemistry of heavier elements in a number of other ways. The combined effect of size and availability of d orbitals considerably influences the ability of these elements to form pi bonds. So example is the what means the pi bond. Usually for the second period elements, what we see, they form pi bond with either with the same element with the other elements of the same period, and these pi bonds are of p pi type, because only p orbitals are taking part in the pi bond formation. And that only p orbitals are taking part in the pi bond formation. That such kind of pi bonding is called p pi bonding. P pi, and the example is what? A carbon. So C double bond C, this we see in ethenes, alkenes. Carbon triple bond, this is a 2 pi bonds here. The alkynes, the nitrogen triple bonds, we see this is the between the same atoms, the multiple bond, the pi bond formation. And we also see the pi bond formation with the hetero atoms with the same period. And the carbon oxygen, carbon monoxide, we see the similar kind, the carbon dioxide as well. sheet double bond N, this kind of bonding we have seen, this CN, HCN, the example. The N double bond O, this pi bonding is also there. And this, what we see, the all the or the orbitals that are involved in this kind of bonding is only the p orbitals, because they do not have any d orbitals. So one vacant orbital, like in this case, what we see is double bond, and this p orbitals of oxygen and p orbitals of carbon, they are taking part in the bond formation. And in this case as well, two p orbitals of the carbon are taking part in the pi bond formation. In this case, two p orbitals of this and two p orbitals of this means the four p orbitals are taking part in pi bond formation, so forming two pi bonds. Similarly, in this case, so the heavier elements do form pi bonds, but this involves d orbitals mostly and not the p orbitals. And so the ones the d orbitals are taking part in the bonding, what the, that kind of bonding is called d pi p pi bonding. So d pi p pi bonding, or d pi of bonding, you can also see if the both the elements belong to the third period onwards. If the both the elements belong to third period onwards, they can also both of the elements, they can have both only the d orbitals taking part in pi bond formation. Or if these third period elements are forming pi bond with the second period element, so second period element will only provide this p orbital and third period element will provide its d orbital, so there will be d pi p pi bonding. So as the d orbitals are higher in energy, and that we know, then p orbitals, they contribute less to the overall stability of molecules than p pi p pi bonding of the second row elements. What does it mean? D pi p pi or d pi bonding are less stable than p pi p pi bonding. And so the pi bonding is not strong for the heavier p block elements. So the pi bonding, usually we don't see that as strong, because the d pi p pi d pi orbitals, they are larger in size and that overlap and other things, it varies. So however, what we see, the coordination number in a species of heavier elements may be higher than for the first element in the same oxidation state. And what is the coordination number that I have explained earlier, and you see the example here. Aluminium is forming bond with the six fluorine atoms, and boron is forming with only four fluoride or the fluorine atoms, although some of them are fluoride, some are neutral. So they are what, they have only four coordination state for the boron, and for aluminium six coordination state. And this is only because of the availability of the vacant d orbitals, and not only the vacant d orbitals, their size is also larger, and because of the larger size, they can have even more ions, more groups surrounding them, which are smaller if they are smaller in size. So the example that we see in the plus 5 oxidation state, both nitrogen and phosphorus, they form oxoanions. Oxo, we know, the carbon, any oxygen double bond with the carbon or nitrogen or any other element, that kind of bond is called the oxo bond. In the carbon, if it forms, usually in the organic chemistry, we call the carbonyl bond. But those carbonyl bonds are also called oxo bonds. Sometimes we also refer them as oxo bonds. So the oxo bonds or carbonyl bond, if the carbon is there, and the nitrogen, this is oxo bond. So what is the oxo anions? The phosphorus is also forming oxo anions, one oxo group is there. However, once you see in them the coordination number, in the case of nitrogen, they have, nitrogen is forming only four bonds. However, four bonds, it has only what, how many electrons here in its valence shell? Only eight electrons. However, if you look at the phosphorus, it is forming five bonds, and five bonds, so 10 electrons are there in outermost shell, outermost cell of phosphorus. So four coordination number involving, and it involves how the 5-10 electrons will be there, because it is also involving d orbitals and the pi bonding. So d orbitals of phosphorus is involved in pi bonding with the p orbitals of oxygen, and that is called a d pi p pi bonding. Here there is a lone pair, the negative charge is also considered as a lone pair. So the oxygen, the negative charge is, it can come here, it can provide its electron, and that negative charge is in the p orbital, extra electron, and that p orbital can have overlap with the another d orbital of the phosphorus if its orientation is, favorable, in the favorable orientation, and then but this bond may shift here. So we see resonance and other things, and one can see the multiple bonding here as well. So the coordination number is differing, that we know, because of the availability of d orbitals. Now let us just briefly take for a few basic things of the boron family. And group boron family is the group 13 element that we have seen. The boron family includes the elements that we have seen earlier: boron, aluminium, gallium, inidium, thallium, indium, thallium, and nihonium. Nihonium is particularly radioactive element that just recently included. It is there in NCRT as well, so you should remember this nihonium. And the boron, nihonium, chemistry of nihonium is not there in our syllabus because its half-life is very small. It's just few seconds. The most stable isotope of nihonium can stay only for few seconds, so one cannot have in that small time can do the chemistry means certain chemical reactions one cannot do. You cannot understand physical properties, and even within that small time you cannot even study the physical properties of such compounds. So the group elements show a wide variation in the properties. The group elements, you know, boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, thallium, and neonium. The group elements show wide variations in properties, and that wide variations is mostly because of that we know the difference in the core electrons on the core that are there. They have different cores for the different elements in the p block. So boron is typically a non-metal, aluminium is a metal but shows many chemical similarities to boron. The gallium, indium, thallium, and nihonium are almost exclusively metallic in character. This is also that we have just seen. So boron is fairly rare element, and this percentage abundance on Earth by mass is only 0.0001%. So boron mainly occurs as a ortho boric acid H3BO3, borax Na2B4O7 and 10H2O, and carnite Na2B4O7 4H2. These are the things you can remember. Even few things you should remember: the borax you should remember, orthoboric acid, carnite. If you don't remember, that is okay. So in India, borax occurs in Pulga Valley, which is in Ladakh, and Sambhar Lake, which is in Rajasthan. So boron mostly occurs there. So there are two naturally occurring isotopes of boron: the naturally occurring isotope boron 11 and boron 10. This is called boron 11, boron 10 isotopes. This way we name them. Boron 11, its percentage abundance is 81%, and boron 10 percentage abundance is 91%, and that is why average atomic mass of boron is more closer to 11. It's slightly less than 11, but it's more closer to 11. So in writing, finding out molecular formula, we usually take 11 because its percentage abundance is very high than the percentage abundance of boron 10. And that's why the mass number of boron 10 we only consider 11 for even calculating the molecular mass of the boron compounds. Aluminium is the now the after the boron, the aluminium is the most abundant metal and the third most abundant element in the on the Earth's crust. And after the aluminium, it is iron. So what we know, the highest most abundant element is what? Oxygen. If you on the Earth's crust, it is 45.5%, but on the entire Earth, if you go, it will be 49.2% around. So almost 50%, half of the elements by mass is oxygen, because atmosphere also contains oxygen. And we know that the silicon is 27.7%. So if you consider entire mass of the Earth, all the elements in the gaseous form in the atmosphere, nitrogen and everything, so its relative mass will decrease. And relative mass, it is around 25% silicon, and then the similarly the aluminium is 7.5% entire. But overall, if on the Earth crust, what we see, the only if you consider Earth crust, this aluminium is 8.3% by mass. Silicon is 27.7%. Silica is in the form of silica, the sand we know, and the quartz, many rocks, it contains and oxygen. Silica contains SiO2. The oxygen is already there with all the silica and all the forms, all the elements, they mostly exist in the form of oxide and some other. So bauxite, what we know, the bauxite is the ore of the aluminium. So Al2O3 2H2O, this formula you should remember, Al2O3 2H2O. And cryolite, Na3AlF6, are the important minerals of aluminium. They are important ores of the aluminium. In India, it is found as a mica in Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Odisha, and Jammu. So Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Odisha, Jammu. In India, the bauxite is missed. Aluminium is found. Gallium, indium, and thallium are less abundant element in nature. And nihonium is a synthetically prepared radioactive element. This is synthetically prepared, it doesn't exist naturally, it is not stable. We have just prepared it in the radio by the transmutation of the elements that we see when we will study the radioactivity. That the term is called transmutation. Transmutation, if you remember, Rutherford discovered because of the reactions of the transmutation. And what he did, he obtained from the nitrogen, he obtained oxygen 17 and as well as one proton. He used nitrogen and neutron and obtained alpha particle on carbon. He used alpha particle on carbon, bombarded alpha particle on the carbon, and what he obtained, oxygen 17 plus one proton. So that kind of conversion, the nuclear reactions are called transmutation of the elements. From one element to another element you will get, and from one element to another element you will get that the same thing you get also in the radioactive decays. And this is called the element that we see, the nihonium is not stable. And most stable isotope, the half-life is only approximately 20 seconds only, and 20 seconds means you can understand how unstable it is. So it's a its chemistry is not established. Why it is not established? Because the most stable isotope is its half-life is only 20 seconds. So all the elements will be only for the few seconds, and they'll be highly radioactive. So it is very dangerous to study their chemistry as well. On the general properties of this boron family members, we will see in the next class. I'll stop here.